Primetime Local News, serving the Lakeland and Midwest regions.
Good evening and thanks for joining us. In less than 3 weeks, all public health orders will be removed in Saskatchewan, with 69% of everyone 12 and older receiving at least one vaccine dose. The province announced that all restrictions will be removed on July 11th. That includes the mandatory mask mandate and gathering limits. The province had previously announced that benchmark was 70% of everyone 12 and older. Two more people who tested positive for COVID-19 in Saskatchewan have died. Both were in the 80-plus age group. One was in our northwest zone and the other in the Regina zone. There are 48 new cases in Saskatchewan, with three in the northwest. One of those is in the immediate Lloydminster area. There are 711 active cases in the province, with 76 in the northwest. Our zone continues to have the third highest active case numbers in the province, behind only Saskatoon and Regina. 76 people are in hospital. This is the lowest number of hospitalizations since November of last year. Eight of those in hospital are in the northwest. Close to 999,000 vaccine doses have been administered province-wide, with almost 64,000 in our zone. It's time now for this week's Retrospect. Here's Blake Nath.
This week in Retrospect. Back in 91, local golfers played a marathon round to raise money for a good cause.
The foursome teed up and took off at about 5 o'clock this morning. Yes, up with the birds as they try to get some birdies. We caught up with them after 36 holes at about 8 o'clock this morning.
Okay, George, longest day of golf working for cancer. How many holes do you think the guys are going to work here today?
Oh, at least 150. I'd like to see 200. We should go to 11 o'clock tonight. We got lots of daylight, and it's a beautiful day.
Early start. Well, how do you feel?
Great.
Think you can make her?
Easy.
They have gone around and around and around, hitting and running and then driving, shot after shot, hole after hole. By 1 o'clock this afternoon, the foursome finished off 72 holes, and they finally took a break.
All right, guys, we've reached pretty well the halfway point. Can we continue, and how many holes can we get in? George, how are you feeling?
Great. I think we'll probably get close to the 200 if we don't have to drag these skinny guys all the time.
And in 96, St. Paul residents bust a move for the Alberta Senior Games.
Edmund and Madeline Fauchu, along with Edmund's sister and brother-in-law Clarence and Simone Labrie, are in training for the upcoming Alberta Senior Games. Their sport is old-time dance.
Some of us take it pretty serious, nervous. Last year, 2 years ago in Lacombe, where we won the gold. So it was quite something to be proud of. So, I mean, I didn't think at that age you could still be in gold.
We had won the bronze in Inton, which was 1994. And last year, well, we brought back the gold medal.
All four are veterans of the sport and veterans of the past senior games. And with this year's games in their hometown of St. Paul, they simply can't wait.
And that's all for this week in Retrospect.
Retrospect this week is brought to you by Webbs Ford. Worth your while to drive the extra mile. Webbs Ford in Vermilion.
Now our Connor Chan will take a first look at your weather forecast.
Mm-hmm. All right, thanks very much, Jasmine. Looking at temperatures right now, still sitting around 24 degrees. Of course, we did warm up quite a bit here compared to what we saw last week, where we, you know, we're a little bit below seasonal averages, but now we're starting to get back into that. We're starting to get some more warm air into the mix here as we start to see winds also kind of pretty consistent at 22 kilometers an hour coming in from the west and southwest as well. Looking at other temperatures in the area, 25 degrees in Vermilion as well as out in Wainwright, 26 degrees for St. Paul and Cold Lake today, 24 degrees also in Marwain, Bonnyville, and in Pierce. 27 degrees in Edmonton, one of the warmer spots today for the immediate Lakeland regions there. So 24 in North Battleford as well, as we see 25 for Maidstone and 21 up in Green Lake. A little bit of not a whole lot to talk about with the satellite radar map right now. A little bit of showers making their way in towards those Meadow Lake areas into the later parts of the evening. So some showers making their way up to the farther north parts of Saskatchewan. A little bit also kind of more so further west as well, but it's more so just the light rain. But we won't be seeing any rain for our area anytime soon, as it is today the official first day of summer. So we're starting to see those warm temperatures come out in spades. So looking at overnight in North Battleford, 9 degrees going into tomorrow. 28 degrees will be the daytime high for them as we go into Cold Lake. 12 degrees overnight with some cloud coverage. 28 will be the high for tomorrow. And we'll see that number pretty consistently throughout our region, including us here in Lloydminster. So 10 degrees overnight, and we're going to have a nice warm day tomorrow with mostly sun and a few clouds there with that high of 28. And looking ahead to Tuesday and Wednesday, we are going to we are going to be a little bit cooler as we are in those little milder temperatures there. So 21 will drop to Wednesday, and then a little bit more cloud coverage will start to emerge for Thursday with that high of 23 degrees as we are. But we're still in those seasonal averages, so we are going to continue to see warm temperatures for the next little while here. That's a look at your weather forecast for now. We'll have more primetime local news coming up after the break.
The NHL playoffs continue to roll with the New York Islanders and Tampa Bay Lightning playing Game 5 tonight. Connor Chan and Evan Kenny have more on the late game heroics and how the series could shape up moving forward.
Well, joining us to talk about all things the NHL playoffs is Evan Kenny. Evan, a few things to talk about. We are in the Final Four, of course, with the series of both the Lightning and the Islanders and the Vegas Golden Knights and Montreal Canadiens all tied up at two games apiece. Let's chat about some last-minute heroics, because that seems to be a little bit of the storyline for both series. Both series have been very low scoring, lots of different things happening in each one. So what are some of those heroic moments that stand out to you in any of those series?
Yeah, Connor, you bring up low scoring. The most goals any team has scored in this semifinals here has been 4, and that happened twice early on in these series. So definitely low scoring. All these teams are playing real tight defense. But unfortunately, like you said, some of these teams are starting to slip up when it comes to the later parts of the game. You know, looking at Game 3 between the Montreal Canadiens and Vegas Golden Knights, I mean, there was that terrible, terrible giveaway there by Marc-Andre Fleury behind the net. So Josh Anderson was able to bury that, sending it to overtime. And then as well, he gets an unbelievable pass to finish in overtime once again. But Nick Waugh, coming from the Vegas Golden Knights, one of the unlikely heroes that we have seen in this series. Not only pots one in the game, but also pots the overtime winner, finding a loose puck in front of the net there. And now, Connor, late game heroics. We'll switch over to the defensive side of the puck here. Ryan Pulock for the New York Islanders. You know, watching that game, I was on the edge of my seat for that last third period there as the Tampa Bay Lightning started to claw back. Game ended up being 3-2, but it could have easily been 3-3 going to overtime if it wasn't for Ryan Pulock sliding out and saving one there from a Ryan McDonagh shot. So, Connor, these guys are leaving it all on the line, and they got to continue to do that through the entire 60 minutes, not just, you know, 58, 59 minutes, or else we could see some more upsets moving forward.
And then you make a good point that save by Ryan Pulock was absolutely huge. And, you know, even though it's not as exciting, we're still getting a lot of excitement from lots of ends there. You know, going forward now, as we talk about some things to talk about, we're, of course, going into Game 5 with Tampa Bay and Islanders really soon. And then, of course, same thing with Vegas and Montreal. You know, with last game with Vegas, I was surprised, you know, they did start Robin Lehner for game four, which did ultimately help in the way. I mean, not to say Marc-Andre Fleury couldn't do the job, but that's going to be a question, I think, for the Vegas Golden Knights going forward is, are they going to continue to play Leonard now that he did win a game, or are they going to try to put Fleury back in there? And then also with Tampa, it's, can they have an answer for that Islanders defense that has played really well as the way that they trap the neutral zone and the way that they haven't been able to break out as much as they like to there, Evan?
Yeah, I agree 100%. The New York Islanders, not just defense as a position, but defense as a team, has been, you know, their bread and butter throughout this series. They did a fantastic job of stopping guys like Nikita Kucherov, like Braden Point, stopping them from getting all that speed in the neutral zone. If you're able to plug them up early on there, it takes away a lot of their scoring chances. And as well, the New York Islanders are doing a great job of getting on the Tampa Bay Lightning in the offensive zone. When Tampa Bay is trying to break out, the Islanders are doing a great job with a 1-2-2 forecheck, really taking away those forward options there. So fantastic job there. And then another team that you mentioned there, Connor, is the Vegas Golden Knights. It will be interesting to see, you know, who gets the start between that tandem of Leonard and Marc-Andre Fleury. Personally, I think you got to give it to Fleury. He's been fantastic throughout the entire playoffs here. I mean, Leonard did obviously get you the win, only giving up one goal, but Fleury has been fantastic. Another point that's fantastic for the Vegas Golden Knights, Connor, is their team defense. And their defense is really starting to produce from an offensive side. Shea Theodore, Alec Martinez, Nick Holden, Braden McNabb each have a goal in this series. And then Alex Pietrangelo, three goals in this series, including two in one game. So that production from the defense there has been fantastic. Now, for the Montreal Canadiens trying to combat that, Vegas does a good job of cycling the puck. So Montreal needs to stay strong and really plug up the middle of the ice there, you know, just taking away those scoring chances, giving Carey Price the chance for some unlucky outside shots there. And then for the Tampa Bay Lightning, Connor, I think they need to get their power play going. I mean, it's one of the most electric offenses in the game of hockey possibly ever. You know, looking at this power play, they've been rolling, but in this series, they haven't done nearly as well, only going 2-for-9 up to that point. So if the power play can start to click, Tampa's looking dangerous.
And when you mentioned that the Islanders have been plugging up the middle for the Tampa Bay guys, it kind of does remind me, unfortunately, of the unfortunate series between the Edmonton Oilers and the Winnipeg Jets when they did such a great job shutting down Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl. For one thing with Vegas as well that really stands out to me, Evan, I think will help them going forward is their depth. They have guys on all four lines that can score and contribute. And I think for them, if they want to try to get past that, get the Montreal Canadiens, who are very resilient and they don't quit on any play given, I think they got to get bodies in front of Carey Price. They got to make sure he gets lots of traffic, because I think it's going to be, you know, aside from all the guys that are in their top six, they can get guys that are the rugged in the corner, as well as just getting traffic in front, like I said, and getting those greasy goals that hopefully will help them win that series.
Yeah, 100%, Connor. When you got a guy like Alex Tuck on your third line, really got to capitalize on that.
Well, Evan, that wraps up this edition of this week's sports panel. Should be a great great rest of hockey as we are into that Final Four, and hopefully who will be emerging as the Stanley Cup finalists. Evan, thanks a lot.
Yeah, thank you, Connor. Should be exciting.
Now our Connor Chan will take another look at your weather forecast.
All right, thanks very much, Jasmine. Yes, still sitting around 24 degrees. A little bit warmer as we make our way out west, as lots of areas finally are starting to get to those high 20s and close to 30-degree temperatures. 27 degrees out in Edmonton, Athabasca, and Edson right now, with 25 for both Red Deer and in Rocky Mountain House. Moving over into Saskatchewan, a little bit milder in some areas like Prince Albert, sitting at 20 degrees, with 24 also in Saskatoon, 23 in North Battleford currently, and then 25 in both Meadow Lake and also in Cold Lake. We could see also some showers in those northern parts of Saskatchewan around that Meadow Lake area. A little bit milder as well as we get to the northern Saskatchewan areas in those mid-teens. 17 in Alosh and Buffalo Narrows and Flin Flon, with 10 in Wollaston Lake, 15 in South End, and then 20 degrees in Uranium City. Looking over to northern parts of Alberta, also fairly warm. Grand Prairie sitting at 28 degrees right now, with 27 in Peace River. High level sitting at 26, with Fort McMurray at 24. Then, of course, warm spots continue to be in those southern Alberta areas as we're close to the 30-degree mark. Medicine Hat sitting at 28 degrees right now, with Lethbridge at 27, along with Calgary, and then Banff sitting at 24 and 26 degrees in Coronation. Moving over to those southern Saskatchewan areas right now, 22 in Moose Jaw today right now, with 23 in Swift Current and 24 in Kindersley, as a lot of that lower pressure is starting to make its way further out east, as there are some showers expected in those Atlantic as well as Ontario and the province of Ontario as well. So 21 also in Regina, and then 20 degrees in Yorkton. As we take a look to those temperatures across the country, degree. Winnipeg's getting those milder temperatures that we got last week, so that system's moving out eastbound there. We could see some more showers in those eastern provinces. We see that right now in Quebec City at 21, 22 degrees in Toronto with some cloud coverage, and a little bit warmer in the Atlantics today as well with 20 in St. John's and 23 in Halifax. 23, also we see that number in Vancouver. Edmonton also seeing, as I mentioned, a little bit of light rain as well throughout the day with that high of 27, so still fairly warm. 21 in Yellowknife and 15 all the way up in Whitehorse. Looking over to temperatures for tomorrow, we are going to be very warm tomorrow as we are going to see temperatures close to 30 degrees. So 28 will be our number here in Lloydminster, along with Maidstone, Vermilion, and Marwain and Bonnyville. 27 up in Cold Lake and Lac-La-Biche and Vegreville, with 28 also in Edmonton. 29 degrees tomorrow for Macklin and North Battleford. And then we'll see 30 degrees in Provost for tomorrow. And we'll see those numbers continuing to rise, at least throughout the sporadical portions of the week, as we are going to get a little bit cooler on Wednesday as we start to see that 21 degrees on that Wednesday. Then we'll have a little bit more cloud coverage coming on Thursday and carrying over into Friday as well, but we'll still be at that 27 degree mark with 28 on Saturday, and then we go to 31 degrees on Sunday. So we'll have some very warm temperatures expected for the next couple of days after Thursday, and then going on to Monday we should see a high there of 32 degrees again. So this could spark the rain of 30 degree temperatures coming back for next week. That is a look at your 7-day forecast. We'll have more Primetime local news coming up after the break.
I'm joined here now with Haley Kwan and Tristan Moisey, and you guys are doing a run to raise awareness and to raise money for charity out of St. Paul. But where did this idea first come from?
We heard about the Kamloops Residential School at the end of May with the 215 children that were discovered. And I think just the past week, we were kind of discussing it with other people, hearing their opinions, and myself personally, I felt a lot of frustration, like with our history and stuff like that, and I wanted to do something. And then my friend Jana from St. Paul ended up starting this run. She said that she was going to do 215 kilometers, and so I asked my brother if he wanted to get in on it, and I think on June 3rd we started our GoFundMe. And yeah, we decided to do running because we're both pretty active in like sports. So, and I use it to cope kind of with my own personal feelings. So it's definitely helped me too.
And what kind of gave you the idea to start a GoFundMe with it as well?
Well, Jana did a GoFundMe to help, I think it's Native Counseling Services. And so we definitely wanted to do a GoFundMe. We took a couple of days to figure out which charity we wanted to go to. But we eventually ended up choosing Canadian Feed the Children just because it supports reservations near us. So there's Satellite Cree Nation, the Whitefish Reservation, and then also it supports Birch Narrows, which is in Saskatchewan, and that's where our dad lives. So it kind of hit close to home. And we think like kids can't learn unless they're like have a full stomach and have a healthy meal. And so we wanted to definitely support the children in our community.
And for you guys' GoFundMe, you actually beaten your original goal. So what did it mean to you to see that you have beaten and how far you've gotten?
It was unbelievable at first.
The first day, I think we doubled it or something, and we're very surprised. We almost had to increase our goal.
Yeah, we definitely like surpassed it, I think, in the first day.
Yeah.
And I think my mom came downstairs, like we posted it like pretty late. On June 3rd, and then in the morning she like came downstairs, she's like, you guys are like past 500 already. And yeah, it really helped that she brought it up to the Maleg school, and like the entire staff was on board with it, and they each donated. And the grade 5-6 class also did a lemonade sale and raised about $300 for this charity. So yeah, it's just really heartwarming that people are on board with this.
So with the run, how far have you guys gotten and how much do you have left?
We're at 135 kilometers and we have 70 left. So that was just between my brother and I. And today we're doing a school-wide run. So we'll see how much we're going to count their kilometers too, because we realize it's quite a bit of kilometers and we need some help.
And you kind of touched on this, but why do you think it was so important for you guys both to participate in this and raise the money?
Like I said, yeah, just going through our own personal feelings about residential schools. And we just wanted to spread awareness, especially in like small town Alberta, where people aren't as educated as like they could be. I can definitely educate myself more. Just educating ourselves along the way and like reflecting. Like I know when Tristan and I run, we're always like thinking like it's a kilometer per child and like every kilometer counts. So
if anyone is looking to support your GoFundMe, where should they go?
It's also in my Instagram bio, and I post updates on Instagram and Facebook on how far we've run each day. Like the support from the community has been amazing. Like one time I was running and my old English teacher like drove by and he was honking and waving. So it's just, yeah, it's been such a positive experience. And I think moving forward, we're definitely going to probably do this again and continue to raise awareness because we were just getting started.
Awesome. Well, thank you both for joining me today.
Thank you so much.
Vince Scott, the first vice president of the Royal Canadian Legion, branch number 39, joins us today here. And we're talking about the upcoming raffle put on by the Legion, where the grand prize is a brand new she shed. So, Vince, what is a she shed for those of us that don't know? And talk about the upcoming raffle as well for the Legion, along with some of the other prizes that the folks can win if they buy tickets.
Well, the she shed is a project that came forward by one of our members on the executive, Scott Gorman, our second vice. And he, because they're very popular out in the East, where Scott's from, so we decided to run with it. We had some local people, their backyard builder, Stan Park, they lent us a shed, which is the same shed as what we're going to be raffling off, and we're actually going to build that on site because they're too big to get in some yards, right? So the shed is it's geared towards the female, so it's going to have planters and flowers and what have you with it. There's a swing. There's going to be I don't know what all there is. It's going to be done up. I'm not part of the decorating committee, so I can't even tell you. So then we have second prize is a $350 day spa at the Just For You. And also there's I don't have it here. There's a wagon that Scott built, a flower wagon for in your garden, whatever. Third prize is a nail spa, pedicure stuff. So that's what that's going to be for. Along with Cheryl Ross donated some stuff from Avon, $100 package from Avon.
How has the response been for this fundraiser so far? I know with COVID, it's been pretty tough, but how's there been good traction with this raffle you guys are doing?
We're almost out of tickets now. I'm running around picking up partial books so that we can have them from when we set up to do our sales. Because the draw is on Canada Day and we're having the celebration at the Legion that day as well. So it's going to be the crunch is on to get them sold. We want to get them all sold and raise as much money as we can for the Legion. Hopefully it carries on.
You did mention it earlier how you partnered up with Backyard Builder. How important was that for you guys to get them on board to help you get this big prize for the raffle?
Well, Backyard Builder, Stan Park, he was very receptive to it, and he's lent us one trade or one shed, and he sold us the other one at a discount. So we can make some money with it. This is one of Scott's projects. That's Bob, that minion there out of tires. He's our mascot right now for the shed. But the Backyard Builder, he's been, Stan Park, he's been very, very, he's been a huge part of what we're doing anyways.
And lastly, Vince, where and when can people buy tickets if they want to enter?
You could get them at Coldwell Banker, where the she shed is sitting right now, the display model. And You can pick them up at the Clip Rose for clothes, or at my shop. I typically have them at Midway when I'm there. But if they go to Clip Rose for clothes or to the Coldwell Bankers, that'd be the place to go. And they can go, you know, to the Legion on Fridays and Saturdays, and or they can wait till Canada Day and try to get it if there's any left.
Vince, I really appreciate your time. Thank you very much for joining us and sharing us the information on how people can enter to win. So thank you.
All right, taking one last look here at your weather forecast. 28 degrees for tomorrow, so we're going to continue to see some warm temperatures throughout the next 7 days. We are going to be we're going to drop a little bit there on Wednesday, Thursday, where we could see a little bit more cloud coverage starting on that Thursday. As we get into Friday with the weekend, we'll start to see those temperatures start to climb once again there. So 27 will be the high there for Friday. Lots more sun expected for Saturday and on Sunday, so a great beach weather day with those highs of 28 and 31 degrees there on Sunday. And then as we get into Monday, 32 degrees will be our high, as we could potentially start to see those 30 degree temperatures starting to come back into next week, into midweek as well, as of course we are now officially into the summer season.
Thank you for joining us on Primetime Local News. Have a great rest of your night.